Good afternoon, and welcome to today's telematics broadcast for Grid11 Accounting. Grid11s, a big welcome to you. Today, we'll be doing a section which is called cost accounting, or we can also call it manufacturing. So what we're going to be busy with is everything to calculate the manufacturing costs, and as we call it, we call that section of the work we call cost accounting or manufacturing. Okay. So what we're doing today, if we have a look in our workbook, you'll see that today's section will be about cost accounting. In your workbook, you'll find it. It will be activity number 3. You'll find it on page 11 and 12. And then in your answer book, it's going to be on page 8 and 9. Now, this section of the work is a section that will be tested in paper 2. This will be exclusively in paper 2. And sometimes it can be a bit integrated, so there might be calculations that appear maybe in paper 1, for example, the depreciation calculation. But mainly, this section of the work will be tested mid-year and at the end of the year in paper 2. It's an easy section of the work, so all learners, what you have to do, is pay careful attention in the class, follow the teacher as he or she is explaining, and you should be able to earn good marks for this section in any paper. Okay, so let's go to that activity. And let's see what's happening. Okay. Right, so the first question they ask you over there to calculate the direct labor. Okay. So before we go anywhere, just remember that we want direct labor. So there's a definition or a concept of what is direct labor all about. So direct labor, we can say it's the wages or the salaries and the contributions of the business of those workers who's directly involved in the production process. So it's all those workers that is directly involved in the production process, and it's their salaries or their wages, plus the employer, plus the business's contribution. So that is just a concept that we have to understand, that direct labor, the salaries or the wages of the factory workers that's directly involved in the production process. Because later on, there might be a definition for indirect labor, okay? So that is what direct labor is all about, okay? Then we have to look at the information that you find. That's information C. Well, let's say there are 5 factory workers that they have worked 120 days each during the year for 8 hours per day at a normal hourly rate of 15 rand per hour, okay? So what we have now, we're going to have a normal time amount, and then because they're working extra, we call that overtime. Now, if you can remember, we did something like this in grade 10, where we had normal time and overtime. Okay, so what we're going to do, we're going to split the direct labor, we're going to split the direct labor into normal time and overtime. So if we have a look at the normal time, it says there was 5 workers. They worked 120 days for 8 hours a day. So if you want to calculate the number of hours they have worked, I take the 120 and I multiply by 8 just to get the number of hours they have worked. And for every hour they have worked, they got paid 15 rand per hour. So there's a slight calculation, which is the 5, so that will be the number of workers. They each worked 120 days. And 8 hours a day. So I want to find out how many hours they have worked. So for that 120 days, for 8 hours, they've worked 960 hours. So what I do, I take my 5, multiplied by the 960 hours, times the 15 rand, and that gives me 72,000 rand. That will just be a normal time. Okay, let's just go over that again. 5 workers, we get that from there. They worked 120 days, we get that from there. And for that 120 days, they each worked 8 hours a day. So I just want to first find out how many hours per day they have worked, which is 960. So I just say 5 times 960 times 15 gives me 72,000. Okay. So this, learners, that means that is just covering the normal time. But that, then it says three workers work the total of 25 hours each. And if they work overtime, they get paid a normal time rate plus 12%. So the normal time rate is 15 rand. So when they work overtime, they don't get paid 15 rand. They get paid 12% more than 15 rand. Okay? So that's also just a calculation. So that's the three workers. Although there were five people, only three of them decided to work overtime. They work 25 hours each. And if they get paid, if they work overtime, they don't get paid 15 rand. They get paid 12% more than 15 rand, which means in this case now, if they work overtime, they get paid 16 rand 80 per hour instead of 15 rand per hour. So 15 rand is the normal time rate. 16 rand 80 is the overtime rate. Okay, so when they work overtime, they get paid 12% more than the normal time. So it's going to be three workers that worked overtime, 25 hours each, times 16 rand 80. That gives me 1,260 rand is the amount that they have worked overtime. Okay, so in this example, there is no contribution. So now it will just be the normal time of the 72 hours plus the overtime of 1,260. So I just have to add that together. So for the direct labor, it will be 73,260. Just make a note of that amount, because later we will be coming back to that particular item over there. That 73,060 that we call the direct labor, that is the salaries and the wages, or the normal time and the overtime, plus the contributions of the workers that is directly involved in the production process. But at this time, there's no contributions, so we just worked it out as normal time 72,000 and overtime as 1,260. I add that together, I get 73,260. Okay, let's move on to the second part of the question. They want us to complete a raw material stock account. So the raw materials is one of the ingredients that we're going to use to manufacture the beanies. So the raw materials is the, it could be the yarn, it could be the material that we're going to use, the wool that we're going to use, if it's a woolen beanie. So that is what we're going to call the raw material. Okay. So if we have to look at the information, we're talking about either direct material or raw material, that will be information B. Okay. Here we have information B. Okay, let's just see what some of these WhatsApps are saying. Okay, a big welcome to the learners in the Eastern Cape. Okay. I see this learner is also from Delft. Okay, welcome to you. Okay, thank you for watching. Okay, let's follow to make sure you understand anything. Then you just send me the message, please. Okay. So now we have, they're talking about direct materials. We want to take the raw materials. The direct materials will be the value of the raw materials that we're sending to the factory for manufacturing. So we can assume that the raw material stock account has a debit balance of 120,000. That's already typed in your answer book, but also in the information. It will be under information A, raw materials on the 1st of March. So here it's a transaction where it says that we purchased raw materials, but cash, okay, for 520. And because it's a stock account, our raw materials will increase on the debit side. Okay, so when we're buying, but the contra entry, in other words, whatever we have to write here in the details, won't be the word cash. Because we're buying cash, right? We're spending the money and it's coming from our bank. That is why we have bank 520,000. Okay, so we've got bank cash purchases. It says that we bought the raw materials for cash. So we have bank 520,000. But in the second transaction, says we bought more raw materials, but this time not cash, we bought it on credit. That means we owe somebody 140,000. And that person that we owe money to is called a creditor. That is why we write creditors control 140,000. Okay, so that will be creditors control 140,000. But in the third transaction, it says raw materials was returned to suppliers. In other words, we sent back some of that stuff that we bought. We sent back 19,000, which means our raw materials will decrease. We'll have creditors control on the credit side, 19,000, indicating that some of that raw materials that we've purchased, we're sending it back to the supplier. It might be defective, so we're sending it back. The business does not want to use it in the manufacturing process. That is why we are returning it to the supplier. So our raw materials is getting less, and obviously now we owe the creditor 19,000 less as well, because now we no longer owe him 140,000. Okay. Then it says that we paid for carriage on the raw materials in cash. In other words, we made an entry in our cash payments. So with that 83,000, going to be on the debit side, you can call it bank, and in brackets, just to indicate that it's for the transport costs of the raw materials, we call it carriage, 83,000. Right, learners, now what we could have done also, because we can combine this 83,000 with that 520,000, okay? Then we just have two entries in there instead of having three entries, because both of them will appear in the cash payments, and we can just call them, it will just be 603,000. But we can also write them separate like we're doing now, and then we can just calculate the figure. Okay? Right, so now we've done all the transactions, so now we have to total. So we get a total of 863,000. So all I'm doing, I'm totaling this, the total of 863,000, and I'm making both sides equal. Then in the information, it says there's a closing balance in the raw materials account of 99,000. Now that raw materials balance that you have left, that is what you're going to start with the next financial year, because this is how much you have left, and obviously that it's a going concern, so you're going to start with 99,000 the following year. So you're going to change the date to the 1st of March. That will be the start of the next financial year. That's whatever raw materials we have this year, we're going to carry forward to the following year. So now we're applying the going concern principle. The business will continue with the operations in the foreseeable future, meaning from the 28th of February until the 1st of March. That is why we are changing the date. Then as you can see, there's a missing figure that we have to calculate over here. So now we're going to go 863,000 minus 99,000 and minus 19,000. Okay, so what we're calculating is the direct material cost. In other words, that's 745,000. I see we've got a big welcome to Groenvlei Secondary as well. That 745,000 is now the missing figure that we have to calculate, which is going to be 863,000 minus 99,000 minus the 19,000 of the goods that we send back. And we call that direct material cost, 745,000. So what is the direct material cost? What is this direct material cost? That is the value of the raw materials that we're going to use in the production process. So that direct material cost, that 745,000, that is how much we're sending to the factory so that they can use those raw materials to produce the goods that we're busy with. And in this case, we're producing the beanies. Okay, so the direct material cost, that is the value of the raw materials that's going to be used in the production process. Okay, just remember that the 99,000 will be in the information A, that will be on page 11. Right, they give you the opening balance and then also give you the closing balance. So the 99,000 is the closing balance, which is on page 11 in the workbook. Okay, so just remember that it was 863 minus what we have left, minus what we send back to get the 745,000. That's the direct material cost, and that's the value of the raw materials that we're going to use in the production process. Okay? Right, learners, then the next thing that they have in the book is where you have to calculate or you have to reconstruct the work in progress account. But let's just say before we do the work in progress, we have to complete the factory overheads account. So for presentation purposes, what we're going to do, we're first going to complete the factory overheads account, and then we'll complete the work in progress account, because we're going to need the factory overheads to complete the work in progress account. Okay, so for the presentation, it will be now the factory overheads account, and we're just moving slightly away from the way it's given in the answer book. Okay, so we're not doing the work in progress, we're first doing the factory overheads, which is the on page 9 in your answer book. Okay. So while that is up there quickly, right? Just remember that the direct material cost is the value of the raw materials used. Okay. So the next thing that we're going to have, it will be the factory overheads. So what factory overheads is, it will list all the expenses that has been incurred in manufacturing the product, and in this case, the beanies. So on the debit side here, we'll have a list of all the expenses, similar to a profit and loss, and some of them might have adjustments. You'll have a list of all the expenses on the debit side, and then at the end, it will just close off to work in progress, because the factory, it will have all those expenses like the rent, for example, the telephone, there might be indirect labor, there could be depreciation on the equipment that's being used, it could be the wages of the cleaner that we're going to need, for example. So all those items that's used in the factory, that will be classified as factory overheads. Okay, so when we do the factory overheads, we obviously have to look at the information that we're going to have, and that will be by information C, for example. That is where the factory overheads also appears, and then on page 12, you'll find the other factory overheads for the year, which is information D. Okay, so we're going to have a look at all those factory overheads. Right, so if you look on the whiteboard that we have over there, the first factory overhead that they're talking about is indirect material. So we're going to look at indirect material. Okay. So indirect material are the materials used in the manufacturing process, but it's not easily identifiable in the final product. Okay? So it's going to be indirect material. So you have to look at the information. In A, for example, you find that there is going to be indirect material. There's a line there for indirect material over there. Okay. So what does it say with the indirect material? It says that you have an opening balance of 4,000. So the opening balance is 4,000. Right. Then, if I look to do anything with indirect material, I see on page 12, the very first item, it says that you've purchased indirect materials to the value of 21,000. So it's your opening balance plus what you've purchased. That is 21,000. So now you have a total of 25,000. But you also have a closing balance. And that closing balance you'll find again by the information, because what they do, they separate it. This is the beginning of the financial year, And that's the end of the financial year. So we started with 4,000. We've purchased 21,000. We have 25,000 available of indirect materials. But at the end of the year, once we've done the stock taking, we see that we only have 4,000 available. That means we have 4,000 left of the 25,000. So that means we take the 4,000, put the 4,000 in brackets so that we minus, and then we can determine how much, is it 4,000? Sorry, it's 2,000. Just take very quickly, it's 2,000. So that is 2,000. And then we say 25,000 minus 2,000 gives you a total of 23,000. Okay. So it's your opening balance of the indirect material plus what you've purchased. That gives you a total of 25,000 minus the 2,000, and then you get an answer of 23,000. So the 23,000, that is the indirect materials that was used in the production process. Okay? So now when we look at the factory overhead account, the first item that I want to put in there is going to be indirect material. And my indirect material will be 23,000, but I have my calculation on the white page. I have my calculation to qualify where I got that 23,000 rand from. So it's just the opening balance plus the purchases gives you 25,000 minus the 2,000 gives you the 23,000. Okay, so the 23,000, that's the value of the indirect materials that was used in the production process. Okay, and if I look at information C, they're talking about, besides the factory workers, the third bullet, they're also mentioning the salary of the factory foreman. Now, the factory foreman, he is in the factory, but he is not directly involved in the production process. So he, in essence, he is part of indirect labor. He is in the factory, but he is in a supervisory capacity. He is just making sure that everybody is doing the work properly. So he is just supervising. That's why it says the factory foreman, that's the person in charge of the factory. Okay? He is just making sure that they're doing their work. And it just says that the amount for the year is 200,000. So there's no adjustment, nothing that you have to calculate. So we're going to take the factory foreman salary just like that. Okay? So that's actually part of indirect labor. He is there, but he's also not part of the direct labor. Okay? He is in the factory, but he's not part of the direct labor. Okay, then learners, the next thing that we have to do, they're talking about the cleaning staff, okay? So while they're busy in the factory, they're wasting, the material is falling everywhere and stuff like that, and we need somebody to come and clean that up for us. So that will be the cleaning staff. But now not only do the cleaning staff clean the factory, they also clean the offices, they also clean the sales department. So they'll be cleaning everywhere, but the bulk of the time they will be cleaning in your factory. That is why cleaning or indirect labor or the wages of the cleaning staff will be part of factory overheads. Okay, so what they're saying, that the cleaning staff so we're going to call them indirect labor. So they earn 7,000 rand per month. So it's 7,000 rand per month, which is very important. Okay, this part here. That means we have to multiply by 12 to get the figure for the year, because it's 7,000 rand per month, and there are 12 months, so we're multiplying by 12, then we get 84,000. So now the first sentence is that the cleaning staff earns 7,000 rand per month. So it's 7,000 times 12 months. That gives me 84,000 rand for the year. Now they say that they spend 75% of that must be allocated to the factory. Okay? So if we do that calculation, would this be 84,000 times 75%? So 63,000 will be the amount for indirect labor for the cleaning staff. Okay. So when we look at the factory overheads account, you find the indirect labor or indirect wages, 63,000. But the calculation on the whiteboard, like we said, that was the cleaning staff. You're going to classify them under the indirect labor, 7,000 rand per month times 12 months gives me the 84,000, and then 75% of that to give me the 63,000. Okay. Right. That was two very important calculations, so you please take note. It's first the adjustment, then we split. We first do the amount, and then we do the split. Okay. That's the next thing. On page 12, the next amount is depreciation. So because there was no calculation or no method for depreciation, that's just the depreciation on the factory equipment, that figure we'll write in just like that. Unadjusted, so it goes in unadjusted, and it's just a straightforward figure of 86,100. But it could be that there was new equipment or old equipment, exactly like the way that we were doing the fixed assets. Because it's equipment, it's a fixed asset, so now that type of calculation can also come in here where you have old equipment and new equipment, and then you have to calculate the depreciation according to the cost price or the diminishing balance. Okay? So never see the exercises in isolation. It could be linked to, for the depreciation, because that is why we did the depreciation earlier in the year when you had asset disposal. So it could all come in here. Okay? But this is just for you to understand the concept of the manufacturing. Okay, then, now they've got all the items where there's just adjustments. So we're just going to look at those adjustments. And the first one they're talking about is rent expense. So if I look at the figure for rent expense, right, just on the whiteboard, the rent expense figure is 107,240. Then they tell me that the rent expense must be shared between the factory and the sales department and the administration department. Okay. So in the ratio, 5:1:1. So we did something similar like to this when we were doing partnerships, where there was a ratio according to capital contribution, maybe, well, maybe 6:9, 3:2, or 1:1. So now because there are three, so we do exactly the same. So what we do, we just say 5 + 1 + 1, that gives you 7. So the portion that we want, the factory, they occupy 5 of the 7, times 107,240. If we wanted to calculate the sales department, then it would have been 1/7. But because we want only the factory, because that will have to go to the factory overheads, we have to calculate the 5 portions because the factory occupies 5 portions of that. So when we do this on the calculator, let's just give you time to calculate that quickly. And I can just see just a big hello for the people in Neisner. Right, it's Percy Madala, and also, okay, Volumzi. Okay, so I take it we have an answer for this. So that will be 76,600. Okay, that's your rent expense. So when you look at, so now all we do, we just have to populate the factory overheads account like we're populating them as we go along with the calculations. And that's what we do. Okay. In the next item that they also have there is they're talking about water and electricity. Okay. So just again on the whiteboard, it's water and electricity. The amount that they give is 110,000. Then it says that has to be split according to the floor area. So the factory, which has 120 square meters, the sales department, which is 60 square meters, and the office or the admin, which is 40 square meters. So now we're back to the same. Now we have to create a ratio again. We can either simplify or we can leave it as it is. So we just add, so that's going to give you 220. So the factory, it's 120 over 220, multiplied with 110,000, and then you get the answer. Okay, so it's a similar calculation to the one that we were doing earlier. Instead, now it is simplified. So this water and electricity is exactly the same. And then we just have to calculate, and that will give us an answer of 60,000. So that's the water and electricity. Okay. And I think just two more calculations quickly. So the other one is insurance. So they're saying insurance. The insurance amount is 24,000. It just says 2/3 must be allocated to the factory. So 2/3 goes to the factory. So the factory gets 2/3 of that figure of 24,000. That should be 16,000. So 16,000 will just go to your insurance as the factory overheads. Right, learners, so now we have populated all the ones that has adjustments, and the only one that we have to add in is will be the sundry factory expenses. So that could be any other expense that is incurred in the factory. That is why it forms part of factory overheads. Okay. Right then, all we have to do, we have to total. So while we're adding all of them, and then factory overheads will close off to work in progress. Okay. So factory overheads will close off to work in progress. So all we're doing here, we're just adding all those figures on the debit side. Gives me a total. I make them equal, and I just close them off to the work in progress. So we just need all those figures on the debit side, and then we just close them off to work in progress. Okay, and as you can see, to complete the double entry, then the factory overheads will now appear on the credit side of the work in progress. Okay. Now let's look at the work in progress account. Right, here we have the work in progress. As you can see, it's work in progress stock. We're busy with, this is where production is taking place. So now we're going to need everything that we have. Right, so, and for that, we only need three things. We obviously have, you must have an opening balance of the previous year. In other words, it's a work in progress. They're busy completing the item. It's not everything is not done. Whatever comes out of work in progress, that is a completed item. So work in progress, we can also call them semi-completed, okay, or half-completed, but they are a work in progress. Okay, so there should be an opening balance. Right, they're giving us an opening balance of 47,000 on the 1st of March. There's an opening balance of 47,000. Right? Then I just take my three components together. What do I need? I need direct material cost. That is what we calculated earlier in the raw material account, the direct material cost. Okay. What else do I need? I need the direct labor. That was the first calculation that we made, the direct material and the direct labor. Now together, the direct material and the direct labor, that will form what we call the prime cost. So direct material and direct labor, they will form the prime cost. Okay. Then the third thing that we need is we need the factory overheads. That was, that came from the factory overheads account. We need to just total that now. Okay, so now we have that. Okay, in this Postmasburg High School. Okay, thank you for tuning in. Okay. Right, that's all the way from the Northern Cape. Right, so now we're looking at, now we have the opening balance. So that was the work that wasn't completed the previous month or the previous financial year, we can also say. So now we're busy completing those items. Then we add on whatever material we're going to get from the raw material stock account, whatever direct labor, that's the salaries and the wages of the workers directly involved. Then all the other factory expenses that were incurred, right? Then, learners, the question mark here is they give you a question mark by the closing balance. So the closing balance is the thing that we have to calculate last. That amount we'll have to calculate right at the end. The closing, because there's a question mark. That means they must give me some information over here by the letter E. They say 18,000 beanies were produced. So if 18,000 beanies were produced, in other words, if we have 18,000 beanies and the cost of production for one beanie was 75 rand. Okay. Then we can calculate what is the total cost of production for those 18,000. So all we have to do there, we take the 18,000 and we multiply with the 75 to get the total cost of production. Well, that will then just be the finished goods that we have done, and that figure will come along now. Right, here we go, that's 1,350,000. Okay, so that will be your finished goods stock. In other words, that will just be in your work in progress account. On the credit side, it says finished goods stock, 1,350,000. And how did we calculate that figure? It was the 18,000 that we completed, and it cost us 75 rand to complete one item or one beanie. So we just multiply the 18,000, multiply by the 75, so we got 1,350,000. As you can see, that figure does not add up to 1,410,000. That means we must still be busy with some items that is not completed yet. It's called a work in progress. That will be the balance that we have to start them. When we come back the following day, then we'll have to start completing those items. So that will be the balance. That will be the balance of the 60,000. Right? So the 60,000 will be the closing balance of the work in progress. That was the figure that we had to calculate loss by just taking the 1,410,000 minus the finished goods stock, 1,350,000. Then we got the 60, and that 60 we're going to start with when it comes back the next day. That's why we changed the date to the 1st of March. The balance that we're starting with the next day, or the start of the new financial year, will be 60,000. Okay, let's just have a look at that again. It's the opening balance, plus the direct material costs, plus your direct labor costs, plus your factory overheads. That is why we had to do the factory overheads first, so that we can bring the factory overheads. Then we totaled them. We made those totals equal. If the closing balance was given, then we could calculate the 1,350,000. But because there was a question mark on the 60,000 in the information, and they gave us 18,000 beanies were completed, so we had to just multiply the 75 rand, so we got the total finished goods stock amount, and then we just had to calculate the closing balance. Okay, those accounts that we were doing now, learners, those are some of the most important accounts when we're doing cost accounting, and it's important that you understand how to complete each and every one of them. Okay, so make sure you work through those examples, you understand what to do, then we can throw any question at you, and then you should be able to answer them well. Okay. Let's see, what else do they want? Okay. They're asking a question here about the break-even point. Okay. So what is the break-even point? So let's just have a look at what they're talking about quickly. It says that we have to calculate the effect on the break-even point. So let's first find out what's the break-even point. The break-even point, it's the minimum number of units that needs to be produced in order not to make a profit or a loss. Okay, In other words, any amount of units more than the break-even point, then the business is making a profit. Okay, so remember, I'm just going to say again, that the break-even point is the number or the minimum number of units that the business must produce in order not to make a loss or a profit. At that particular point, the total income is covering all the expenses. So the business is making a profit or a loss. If you can remember from, if you can see, if you want to make a comparison, we can say it's more or less the equilibrium, like in the EMS that you were doing where the demand and the supply is meeting. So at that particular point, there's no profit or no loss. That's the balancing, that's the equilibrium. So the break-even point, the number of units that we want to produce in order not to make a profit or a loss. If you're producing more than the break-even point, then we're making a profit. If you're producing less than the break-even point, then the company is running a loss or the business will be incurring a loss. Okay, so the break-even point is something very important that you have to understand. It's the minimum number of units that they need to produce not to make a profit or a loss. Then there's a formula for break-even point, something that we just have to remember. It says it's the total fixed cost divided by the selling price per unit minus the variable cost per unit. Okay, the selling price per unit, that is how much we're selling the article for, and the variable cost per unit, that will be your direct material, your direct labor, and your sales and distribution per unit. And then also the selling price per unit and the variable cost per unit, selling price minus the variable cost, is called your contribution. In other words, how much of the selling price is being contributed towards the fixed cost or to cover the fixed costs. Okay, that's why it says break-even point. So that's two concepts that we have to understand quickly. The one is the break-even point, and then similarly we have to know the formula on how to calculate the break-even point. Also, the answer of the break-even point is never in rands, because it says the minimum number of units. So in this example, it will be 12,600 beanies. That is what they calculated. Okay, so let's see what's the question. So we've got the formula for the break-even point. It's the total fixed cost divided by the contribution. Now they want to know, what will the effect be if my raw materials decrease? In other words, if my raw materials decrease, so we have to, first of all, we have to classify the raw materials. What will happen if the raw materials decrease? So raw materials is a variable cost. So if my variable cost decrease, then my contribution will become more. In other words, the denominator will become more. So what's going to happen? That the effect on the break-even point, it will decrease. Okay. Why? Because the number at the bottom, the denominator, that number will become bigger. And if you are dividing by a bigger number, your answer will become smaller. So we're saying that the variable cost decrease, therefore the contribution increase, and the effect will be that the break-even point, that number will decrease. In other words, you'll have produced less to break even. Okay. All right, so what they're saying is that if the raw materials, or what we do, we classify the raw materials. Raw materials is classified as a variable cost. So my variable cost is decreasing. Okay. So if the number at the bottom becomes smaller, if the variable cost becomes smaller, the contribution will become bigger. That means you're dividing by a bigger number, so the answer will become smaller. So therefore, the break-even point will decrease. Okay. In the second example, they're talking about the factory rent. Okay. Also, just welcome to Makapula Secondary. Okay, thank you. And there's people in George also coming to watch. Kato, Imazamo, Yetu, in George, welcome. And what's going to happen to the factory rent? If the rent increase, what will the effect be on the break-even point? So that's the formula that we have to look at. So the factory rent, that is classified as a fixed cost. Okay? So now we're saying that if my fixed costs increase, if the number on top, right, which is the numerator, if that amount increases and everything else remains the same, then what will happen? We'll have an increase in the break-even point. Okay. So if my, again, factory rent classified as a fixed cost, factory overhead, so that will be fixed. If that number increases, then my answer will also increase, which means the break-even point will increase. Right, so what will my reason be? Fixed cost increase. Here we go, the fixed cost increase. Therefore, that will increase. Okay, let's just go back quickly. Here we go. The rent increase, right? So my fixed cost increase. So now my break-even point will also increase. Okay, then the last one. What will happen if my selling price per beanie increase? So what they're saying, if my selling price increase, then again, the denominator, the number at the bottom, that will become bigger. I'm dividing by a bigger number, so my answer should become smaller. So the break-even point will decrease. Why? Because the contribution increased. Okay. So that's just something that you have to play with when you're looking at what the formula is for the break-even point, so that you can understand is the break-even point going to increase or decrease. The effect is the increase or the decrease in the break-even point. Okay? The reason is our fixed cost is increasing, like in the example for the factory rent, or maybe the raw materials is the variable cost, so that will decrease. So my answer will become bigger at the bottom, so my final answer will become smaller. Okay? Right, learners, in this section, that was just the final answer. Let me just see if there's some more WhatsApps quickly. Let me just see if I can, if any questions quickly. Okay, they just have to go onto the telematics so that they can download the link. Or when we update the telematics channel, then they can just go and download the presentation if they want to do so. Okay, but so what's important also, you can just have to follow, follow the videos and then you'll get it. But once we've updated the website, and then you'll get the videos will be available, or the presentation will be available. Okay. Right, learners, I think that is about covered the question that we did for today. And I think it's almost time that we have to just round up a few things. What's very important and you need to understand is that you must be able to define what is raw materials, what is direct labor, what is direct material cost, the difference between indirect and direct. You must understand how to calculate and what does the break-even point mean. If they're producing more than the break-even point, then the business is making a profit. If they're producing less than the break-even point, then the business is running a loss. Okay? Then clearly the owner won't be happy if he's making a loss. That is why we have to determine the break-even point before they take on any orders. So they make the calculations, and then they determine what the break-even point is, and then they will decide, okay, right, this is what we need for the break-even point, and how many do we want to produce? Is this project that we want to undertake, is it viable or not viable? If you see that you're going to run a loss, then you don't do that item of production. Okay. So all I need to do, learners, I wish you well for the mid-year exams, and also just remember, again, that the cost accounting will be tested in mid-year and at the end of the year in paper 2. Okay, so you please need to separate your papers carefully, know exactly what content you need to study for paper 1 as well as for paper 2. Like I say again, cost accounting will be in paper 2. And everything of the best for the upcoming June exams. Hope you had a wonderful afternoon. It was nice to see all the people that was interacting with me. Thank you very much for your attendance. Until I see you again next time, goodbye.